years since the powerful investment bank Lehman Brothers filed for bankruptcy. In the days that followed, global financial markets lost 60% of their value. Global economy contracted by 5%. An estimated 8.8 million jobs were lost, and $19 trillion of household wealth was wiped out. Why didn't anyone serve jail term for such losses? Is the world any safer now? And what did it feel to be at the helm of policy making in those dizzy days? In our series, Lehman Crisis 10 Years On, we speak to the men who mattered in 2008, here in India and abroad, to get answers to some of these questions. Today, I have with me a person who was an equally powerful policy maker in those days. I have with me Mr. Montek Ahluwalia, who is Deputy Chairman of the Planning Commission. He was also, of course, Finance Secretary in the past decade and was in the closed group of decision makers who were advising Prime Minister Manmohan Singh at that time. Mr. Ahluwalia, thank you very much indeed for joining us in this special series. Well, first up, what exactly was the thought process? How were you informed on the night of September 15th? And what was the immediate reaction in Delhi? Were you on telephone with the Prime Minister and with the Finance Minister on the night of September 15th itself?
No, certainly not on the night of September the 15th. I mean, I actually remember that they filed for bankruptcy sometime in the morning of September the 15th. And I don't even remember the news breaking that dramatically that evening. It was the next morning on September the 16th that we saw it in the newspapers. Now, at that point, I mean, it is not as if there was no sign that there were problems. I mean, we knew that the subprime crisis was building up. Mm. We had seen Bear Stearns being absorbed by another major bank a few months earlier. The difference here was the fourth largest investment bank in the United States went bankrupt. So that was clearly a bit of a shock. It's only in subsequent days when the extent of the contagion, these toxic assets were not just concentrated in the U.S. banking system. They actually had spread over in the European system also. And secondly, the sudden lack of trust within the banking system, that nobody quite knew whose balance sheet was going to go next. I mean, after all, Merrill Lynch was bought over, so we knew that something big is happening.
Yes.
But, the notion that this might be the beginning of the Great Recession, that, I think, came a little bit later, essentially when the stock market looked as if it was crashing. I mean, I remember briefing Dr. Manmohan saying that in the couple of weeks after the Lehman Brothers crisis, the movement of the stock index seemed to practically mirror, in proportional terms, what had happened in 1929. So then people got very worried indeed.
Okay. Was it not a matter of shock that at that time the call rates in India went through the roof, bond yields went up as well, money, a lot of dollars fled from India. We saw a sharp attack on the rupee. So was it a time when there were, daily or maybe hourly contacts with the Reserve Bank as well? I'm just trying to ask you to live through those early days, from September 16 to September 30.
I'm quite sure that between the Finance Ministry and the Reserve Bank, there would have been very frequent meetings. But, a sign of the unusual nature of the crisis was that an apex committee was set up. Dr. Manmohan Singh, as Prime Minister, would chair it. Finance Minister was a member. I was also invited on a couple of meetings, the Governor, RBI, who had just taken over. There were meetings at a high level, and that was unusual because normally macroeconomic management was never discussed in a group chaired by the Prime Minister. This time it was, because I think people realized that's a big crisis. As far as the call money rate and all going up, I don't know what others, but I was not directly handling this.
Yes.
We were much more interconnected than many people thought. Because, although clearly we didn't have an open capital account, the fact is that indirectly and other ways, a lot of liquidity came into India, which was going to be affected by liquidity conditions elsewhere. So when you had a kind of a flight to quality, and people simply withdrew, shrunk their balance sheets in markets about which they didn't know very much, and you know, India would be one of the peripheral markets, even a small withdrawal would cause a big spike, and that is why we pushed very hard for a rapid loosening of monetary policy. These meetings led to a conscious decision that we needed to resort to both a fiscal stimulus and a monetary relaxation, which actually was a reversal of what we had been doing. Because, you know, on the fiscal side, we had a fantastic improvement in the fiscal deficit, and we were very proud of it. On the monetary side, we'd been doing all this tightening. All of a sudden, everything goes in reverse.
Yeah, I just want to tell you that...
Which was the right thing to do at the time.
Yeah. No, I just spoke with Dr. Reddy and Dr. Subba Rao. Subba Rao had taken over on September 5th, and the Lehman crisis hit on the night of September 15, as you say. And yes, monetary policy also had to be reversed completely. But Mr. Ahluwalia, you know, we cut our rates all the way from, 9% when Dr. Reddy's term ended to about 3.25%. That was something I discussed with Dr. Subba Rao. But fiscal policy, I remember so well at that time, that 2.6% fiscal deficit, which was budgeted for that year, ended at 3.3. And then the subsequent years, it became 4% and went up to a peak of 4.8%. Now, as you look at it 10 years later, do you think that was an excess?
You know, the 2008-2009 increase in the deficit was a result of a fiscal stimulus that was injected into the system in December and February, okay? And given the delays that exist in our system, it took a long time before we could make out whether something was really working or not. And secondly, the government was heading for an election.
Yes.
So the Prime Minister, as you know, Mr. Chidambaram moved in November to become Home Minister. The Prime Minister took charge of the Finance Ministry, but in January he had a bypass surgery. So External Affairs Minister Pranab Mukherjee became acting finance minister, and he had to present an interim budget. Okay. Now, by the way, this is an interesting thing. You know, a parliamentary convention says interim budget should not say anything more expenditure than in the last year, which is actually ridiculous because, you know, if inflation is going to be 8-9% at that time, that is a highly contractionary signal. So, in fact, I had a discussion with him, and I said, "Sir, I know the parliamentary tradition forces you to produce a budget which doesn't go beyond 2008-9, but you should actually say that we're going to need to do more in July if we come back." And of course, whichever government comes would have to do it. And he did signal that. Now, when the new government came in, a conscious decision was taken that we are going to have a higher fiscal deficit than was scheduled for the previous year. Okay, I think it's very important to remember that at that time, there was a lot of uncertainty globally about how effective the global recovery is going to be. I mean, remember, the G20 only agreed on a strategy in April of 2009.
Yes. Okay?
And that strategy said that all countries must resort to both monetary and fiscal stimulus to the extent to which they can. Now, our view was that the industrialized countries should do a lot more fiscal expansion than they were willing to do. And, you know, it's possible that if they had done what we were asking for, we would have had to do less.
Okay.
But since we knew they were not willing to do that, we had a choice. Do we or do we not try to revive the economy? The IMF visited India at that time to make an assessment of 2008-2009. And, you know, in their Article 4 report, they said that, look, your growth rate has gone down in 2008-2009 to about, 6.7% or something. And we expect this will decelerate further to 5.5% in the year 2009-2010. It is because of the fiscal stimulus and the monetary one that we actually ended up with a growth rate above 8%. So in a way, we disproved the IMF And for a couple of years internationally, there was much celebration of India's resilience.
Yes.
Okay, now I want to concede one point. I mean, I think in 2010, 2011, we should have withdrawn the stimulus more. That's one point. The second is a lot of the stimulus was the failure to raise petroleum prices. The deficit became very large, properly computed, because the oil subsidy exploded.
No, I take...
Politically, this was not easy to do.
I agree. I mean, I completely take that point, but let me come wind back to that 2008-09, and that's why I was trying to interrupt. When you were advising the finance minister to go ahead and signal higher expenditure, and indeed the fiscal deficit in FY 2009-10 was much higher, I think, budgeted itself at 4% or so. I got a phone call from a very senior ex-RBI person who told me, will you stop calling this a crisis? This is a government which is going to elections. You give them an intellectual argument, a global argument to spend, and they will blow the deficit. Stop calling this a crisis. This is not a very Indian crisis. So, even at that time, the Reserve Bank, of course, this is a former Reserve Bank official, they were very conscious that perhaps we are spending more than we should. Wasn't that advice given to the Council of Ministers as well?
Well, I have no idea what I don't know exactly what the Reserve Bank governor said to the finance minister, but let me say that all central banks tend to be fiscal hawks, in the sense they believe that if you keep the fiscal deficit down and leave everything to the central bank to manage, everything will be fine. I just do not believe that is correct. So whoever this official was, he was doing the central bank dharma. Now, generally, I think the RBI has been right in saying that too much pressure is put on it because of the fiscal deficit being a little higher than it should be. But I think when you have a crisis, then I think you really need to signal that you're going to step in.
Okay.
So, irrespective of the election, actually, my advice to the finance minister in February of 2009, to Mr. Mukherjee, which he actually reflected in his speech, I said, look, ideally we should be giving a signal that we are going to increase the deficit, but you can't do that in an interim budget, so why don't you have a separate paragraph saying, and he did, he had a few lines. I mean, I had said, look, why don't you say we're going to have to increase expenditure by up to 1% of GDP. He moderated that to say half to 1%, okay? So I would have said that has nothing to do with the election. I mean, look, even if the government had just won an election, this is what they should have done. The real mistake, I think, was in 2010. And those things have nothing to do with the election. I mean, governments just hate raising administered prices. And that's why I don't think we should have too many administered prices.
Yeah. No, let me just dwell on this point a little further. Now, on hindsight, do you regret that, that even fiscal deficit should not have gone that high, even in FY9-10, not just in subsequent years, even in the previous year, you should have tightened it for the simple reason that quite clearly 8% growth was not sustainable. Look at our long-range growth. I mean, if you take a 20-year period, it is still 7%. Even now, the Reserve Bank has almost admitted in some of its research papers that our potential growth is probably closer to 7%. Wasn't that that growth purchased by high deficit? On hindsight, will you say that we should not have gone in for a higher fiscal deficit even in FY10?
Let me say that you say our long-term growth was 7%, but in the previous 5 or 6 years, the growth rate was over 8%. So it is very difficult to know at any given time what is the growth rate that you should be aiming at.
Fair point.
I think at that point, the 11th plan had said 9%, and the finance minister had said 9%. Now, remember, in the intellectual debate at the time, nobody said that you should go for less. As a matter of fact, as deputy chairman, when I chose the 9% growth rate, Most of the people were saying, you are being too timid, and why don't you grow for 10%? Because the economy has been growing at 9.5% in the previous 3 years. So, you know, opinions do change. On the whole, I would say my real regret about that period, and I'm writing about this in my book. See, I think I would have been happier if more of the stimulus had come from investment, particularly in infrastructure, and less from a tax reduction. Now, you know, that runs into a bit of a problem, because a lot of people will tell you that the easiest way to get consumption expenditure going is to reduce taxes. Whereas if you try to increase expenditure, you need to have projects that are ready, you need to have capability, the project guys have to be mobilized on the ground and so on, and I accept that. So answer is no regrets at all on 2009, 2010. Yes, regrets on 2010, 2011, and even there, in my view, yep, we should have corrected the petroleum prices.
Okay. Now, I take your point on the fact that petroleum prices were a big culprit, but and I also take your point that the prevailing wisdom at that time was that we would grow by 8% almost forever. But I must tell you again, the central bank governor who advised me that...
Not 6%, by the way.
No, no.
You said 6%?
No, 8%. Let me just rephrase the question.
Well, actually, we can grow by 9%.
Yeah. No, Mr. Ahluwalia, I take your point that at that time, the prevailing thinking was that India would grow over 8% practically forever and maybe, you know, scale up to 9 and 10%. But let me tell you that the senior central banker I'm referring to did tell me that even in 2008-09, when he was speaking with me, he said, we should learn to scale down growth. And he particularly pointed to the wisdom of, I don't know whether it was Wen Jiabo or Hu Jintao, who was heading People's Party in China. He actually went to the party and said that China can't sustain 13% growth. We must scale down to 10% and further lower. So, you know, political leadership at that time in China recognized that we have to advise slower growth or we will trip and fall. So, you know, some leadership did see that very high growth is unsustainable for their own economies. And the central banker pointed it to me. I just wanted to tell you that this was perhaps an outlier opinion, but it was there. Permit me to take a break. I'm coming back.
Well, you know, please...
Yeah. Please, go ahead, sir. Go ahead.
Please let your readers know.
Yes.
I agree with the Chinese who said we can't grow at 13%. But I do not agree with the Indians who said 8% is too high. I mean, we should be quite clear about this,
okay,
that the underlying capacity for growth, we were far behind China. China had grown very rapidly for 25 years. It made sense for Chinese central bankers to ask for slower growth. I guess it made sense for our central bankers to do the same thing.
Okay.
But it made sense for us not to listen
to
that.
Right. Okay. Point taken, sir. We have to take a mandatory break. I'm coming back with questions on how you see the current global scenario and whether fresh bubbles are appearing, especially whether there's fresh trouble for emerging markets. Back in a minute.